Namaste, welcome to this edition of Weekly Dialogues. And today I have Abhijit Chawla with me. Abhijit Chawla, you know him very well from earlier Jaipur Dialogues, where he was here as an expert on Aryan invasion theory. And he also has to his credit कि ये कई सारे जो amateurs आते हैं Aryan invasion theory को support करते हुए, तो उनकी ये ऐसी तैसी करते रहे हैं और आगे भी मुझे उम्मीद है करते रहेंगे. एंड ही वॉज प्रेजेंट ड्यूरिंग दैट फेमस इंटरेक्शन इन विच वी अनाउंस्ड विद ग्रेट फैनफेयर एंड विद ग्रेट सेल्फ एश्योरेंस दैट एनीबॉडी हु कैन प्रूव द आर्यन इन्वेजन थ्योरी करेक्ट विल विन 2 crore rupees फ्रॉम जयपुर डायलॉग. एंड ही इज वन ऑफ दोज हु बैक्स दैट अवार्ड अप. इनका कहना है कि ये इसमें शामिल है कि जो कोई भी इसको प्रूव कर देगा उसको 2 crore देने वाले में ये भी शामिल है, लेकिन अभी तक कोई क्लेम तक नहीं कर पाया. अभिजीत जी नमस्कार.
नमस्कार, थैंक यू फॉर हैविंग मी.
अभिजीत जी इज बेसिकली अ थ्योरेटिकल फिजिसिस्ट विच इज अ वेरी डिफिकल्ट कॉलिंग, लेकिन इनका शौक है जो इंडिक मैटर्स, इंडियन फिलोसफी, इंडियन हिस्ट्री, इन सब चीज़ों में इनका बड़ा इंटरेस्ट है और ये अक्सर लिखते रहते हैं. आपने इनको देखा भी होगा, पहले इंडियन इंटरेस्ट नाम के से इनकी बड़ी एक फेमस ट्विटर हैंडल था, अब उसको चेंज करके इन्होंने अपने नाम से कर लिया है. सो एट द रेट अभिजीत चावड़ा इज इज ट्विटर हैंडल. एनीबॉडी ऑफ यू हु इज इंटरेस्टेड कैन ऑलवेज फॉलो हिम. आज हम एक बड़े इंटरेस्टिंग सब्जेक्ट पे बात करने जा रहे हैं और ये कहाँ से शुरू होता है कि मैंने एक पुस्तक लिखी थी कृष्ण गोपेश्वर, वो मैं अभी 2 मिनट में आपको दिखा दूंगा. कृष्ण गोपेश्वर, उस कृष्ण गोपेश्वर पुस्तक में ये हुआ था कि उस पर मैंने जानबूझ के स्वस्तिक जो था वो लेफ्ट हैंडेड स्वस्तिक बनाया था और that had a certain intent, that left-handed swastika was intentional. ये मैं आपको दिखाता हूँ, you can have a look. This is it. This is the book and that is the swastika. So I got badgered by the left and by the right. I got badgered by the left because swastika as such is anathema to them. कोई भी भारतीय चिन्ह, कोई भी इंडिक सिंबल उनके लिए एक हेट सिंबल है और दैट ऑफ कोर्स इज अ प्रॉब्लम विद द लेफ्ट. एंड वी आल्सो हैड अ प्रॉब्लम विद द राइट कि जो भी हमारे भारतीय परंपरा के लोग थे, जो भी इस तरह के लोग थे, वो सारे हमारे पीछे ही आ गए कहते हुए कि ये आपने स्वस्तिक जो है वो गलत बना दिया और इससे आपने भारतीय परंपरा का अपमान किया है. You are actually demeaning our traditions. और आज हम अभिजीत जी से इस स्वस्तिक चिन्ह के बारे में बात करने जा रहे हैं. We are going to talk to Abhijit about the swastik symbol. And the swastik symbol is not exactly the way you think. Abhijit ji, over to you.
Thank you very much. So let's begin with slide 1, please. So let me give an introduction ki swastik kya cheez hai. So swastik, as we know very well, it is a very auspicious symbol in India and throughout the greater sphere of India's culture and influence. But what we don't really know is that it's been prevalent in the past as an auspicious symbol throughout the world, in various different cultures throughout the world, in every single continent in the world except for Australia. So can you please go to slide number 2? So yes, this is the map. ये जो map है इसके ऊपर हमें दिख रहा है कि कहाँ कहाँ in the world we have been able to find the swastika, either as a living symbol or as something that was found in the archaeological record. So let me briefly go through the history of the swastika. Where is it found and what is the ancient belief behind it? So first of all, as we know very well, it is found throughout the Indian subcontinent from the earliest time period that we have excavated. So the earliest presence of the swastika in the Indian subcontinent is from the so-called Indus Valley civilization, which I prefer to call as the Saraswati civilization for obvious reasons. So it's found throughout the time span of the Indus Valley civilization, the Saraswati civilization, from the very beginning. The earliest swastikas that we have found in the archaeological record in India are about 5,000 to 6,000 years old. So they are found as seals in the Saraswati civilization. They are found on pottery. They are found everywhere. And even in the later time period of our civilization, it's been found in all time periods. It's still present in India today. It's a living symbol of positivity, of auspiciousness. So it's found in India for sure. It's also found throughout the ancient Indo-European world, which is pre-Christian Europe. So if we look at the continent of Eurasia, which is a single continent, then this continent, most of it was part of an ancient, vast cultural continuum of a single culture, the so-called Indo-European culture, with India as the easternmost part of it. And it extended all the way into Europe to the westernmost part of Europe, the Irish Isles. So the oldest example of this culture is obviously India's Vedic culture. And from here, it spread throughout the Indo-European world. So the swastika is found as an auspicious symbol throughout this entire vast cultural continuum. For example, in Persia, we have lots of examples of the swastika in Persia. We have examples of swastika in Armenia. Today, if you look at Armenia, the system of writing of Armenia, the alphabet of Armenia, it is entirely based on variations of the swastika. So it is a very positive and auspicious symbol in Armenia. It was found as a positive and auspicious symbol throughout Scythia, which is the entire region of the Eurasian steppe. The Scythians were known as Shakas by ancient Indians and Persians. And it is well known that the Scythians eventually invaded India and settled in India. It is believed that people of northern and western India have some Scythian heritage, especially the Jats and the Rajputs. So the Scythians considered it to be an auspicious symbol. The people of ancient Mesopotamia considered it to be an auspicious symbol. Greece. In Greece also, it was a very auspicious and positive symbol. In the city of Troy in Anatolia, which is part of ancient Greece, there have been more than 1,800 examples of the swastika found, which are like older than 3,000 years old. So it has a very significant presence in Greece. If you move further westwards, if you go to Rome, we should know that Rome is an extension or an offshoot of Greek civilization. And even in Rome, the swastika was prevalent everywhere. It was ubiquitous as a symbol of positivity and auspiciousness. It was found in houses, in mosaics on the wall, in mosaics on the floors. It was found in temples to the gods and to various divinities. So it was found everywhere. The swastika is found in Slavic culture, in Celtic culture. Slavic culture means Greater Russia. Celtic culture means Western Europe, France, Spain, and the British Isles. The swastika is a very auspicious symbol among the Vikings, the ancient Vikings. It was also found in Germany. It was found in Lithuania, which is very, Lithuanian culture is very similar to India's ancient Vedic culture. And the language too is very similar to Sanskrit. So it was found throughout the ancient Indo-European world. Apart from the continent of Eurasia, the swastika was found throughout Africa, Northern Africa, Carthage, for example, Libya, Tunisia, and even the central parts of Africa, like, for example, Nigeria and the Ashanti Kingdom, etc. So it's found throughout Africa. You find examples of the swastika in the archaeological record as well as a living symbol in Africa today. It's found in the Mediterranean region, Lebanon, Israel, etc. It's found in the indigenous cultures of North America as an auspicious symbol, in the indigenous cultures of South America and Central America. The only continent where the swastika is not seen is Australia. Now, apart from these things, the swastika has been observed very widely in the Christian world, which is very, very surprising because Christianity essentially supplanted the old Indo-European culture in Europe via violent means. And this has been depicted, this has been brought out very nicely in the book, The Darkening Age by Catherine Nixie. So even though Christianity supplanted and dismantled the Indo-European culture throughout Europe, it still retained the swastika. It essentially tolerated the swastika as if it was brought into the Christian symbology in a syncretic manner. So you find swastikas in churches. You find swastikas in the robes of various Christian clergy. You find swastikas on Christian statues of Christian state for Christian saints. So it's found throughout the Christian world. It's also found in the Islamic world. If you look at mosques in Persia, if you look at mosques in Central Asia, if you look at the various mosques in other parts of the Islamic world, even in Spain, which was conquered by the Moors, you find swastika artwork everywhere. For example, today in Saudi Arabia, in the city of Mecca, there is the world's largest clock tower. On this clock tower, there are swastika symbols inscribed on it, which is very surprising, but it's there. The swastika is also seen in the tomb of Timur the Lame. Timur the Lame, as you would know, was a dreadful, monstrous plunderer and genocide perpetrator who killed at least 17 million people in India and in Persia and various parts of Central Asia. So in the tomb of Timur, you will find swastika patterns and various other places in the Islamic world. And also in the Indian cultural sphere, if we go east from India, Southeast Asia, Myanmar, Thailand, our neighboring countries, also Malaysia, Singapore, Indonesia, Vietnam, Laos, the Philippines, Cambodia, all these countries, it is a very positive and auspicious symbol in China. China has the world's largest Buddhist population, more than 200 million people. So it's a very positive symbol in China. It is very highly venerated in Mongolia, also in Korea, and it is very highly venerated also in Japan. If you look at Google Maps, if you go to any Japanese city and search for temples, temples are depicted with swastikas on Google Maps in Japan. So it was found throughout the ancient world, but today it is primarily an Indian and Dharmic symbol because it has been mostly eradicated from most parts of the world, including Africa, which has been largely Africa's ancient indigenous culture has been mostly wiped out, and it's been replaced by, you know what I mean, European culture and religion. So today the swastika is primarily a Dharmic symbol, an Indian symbol. It's found throughout the Indian cultural sphere of influence. So that's an introduction of what...
Yes. Well, this is a very interesting introduction that you made. In fact, let me tell my viewers, aapko bata do ki inka jo pura presentation tha, wo 160 slides ka tha. So, because we were trying to have it in about 30 minutes or so. So, isko humne isko shorten kiya. Yadi kisi ko vishesh interest ho, aur bhi detail mein janne ka, to hum Abhijit ji ka इस पे एड्रेस डाल देंगे और आप उनसे डायरेक्ट इंटरेक्ट कर सकते हैं। क्या आप ऐसा कभी और मौका लगा तो वो पूरा का पूरा 160 स्लाइड्स का डेक भी हम आपको बता सकते हैं। और एक चीज मैं और अपने व्यूअर्स को कह दूं कि ये जो आज का जो प्रोग्राम है, ये हमारा कालबोध सीरीज का प्रोग्राम है। शुरू में मैंने शायद वीकली डायलॉग्स कह दिया था, ये कालबोध सीरीज का प्रोग्राम है जिसमें हम अपनी धार्मिक परंपरा की बातें किया करते हैं। और यदि आपको ये अच्छा लगता है तो इसको कृपया लाइक, सब्सक्राइब और शेयर करें। अब नेक्स्ट आई वांट टू नो, अभिजीत जी प्लीज टेल अस कि स्वस्तिक बीइंग सच अ यूबिक्यूटस सिंबल एंड बीइंग फाउंड एवरीवेयर, हाउ इज इट दैट देयर इज आल्सो सम डिस्टिंक्शन बिटवीन द टाइप्स ऑफ स्वस्तिक्स दैट यू हैव राइट हैंड स्वस्तिकस विच इज द कॉमनेस्ट, जिसको हम ऑस्पिशियस की बात करते हैं, देन वी ऑल्सो हैव द लेफ्ट हैंड स्वस्तिकस विच आई यूज्ड, ऑफकोर्स आई नो वाई आई यूज इट, बट आई विल रिक्वेस्ट यू टू एनलाइटन आवर पीपल एंड द अदर कॉमन फैलसीज दैट आर एसोसिएटेड विद स्वस्तिकस इंक्लूडिंग द एंगुलर स्वस्तिकस एंड ऑल, एंड इट इज आफ्टर दैट देन in the end we will also discuss the what I'll call the misuse of swastika, but that will be towards the end. But filhal hame ye bataye ki ye jo iske common misconceptions or fallacies jo associated hai swastika se wo kya hai.
Right. So the swastika, it occurs in many different forms. If you look at the different cultures in the world, there are swastikas with various different shapes. There are patterns based on the swastika that are geometric in nature. But the two most common swastikas, like you said, are the right-handed swastika and the left-handed swastika. So in our Indian culture, especially Hindu culture, what is now known as the Hindu culture, because the religions have been separated out. So in our Hindu culture, the right-handed swastika is the most common form of the swastika. And the left-handed form of the swastika, the mirror opposite of that right-handed swastika is also there. It is in Hinduism, it is most commonly associated with Tantra and the worship of Kali. So it is kind of a heterodox version of the mainstream swastika in our Hindu culture, in the mainstream Hindu culture. Of course, in Jainism also you have the swastika. But if you look at the left-handed swastika, it is most commonly found in Tibetan Buddhism and various other forms of Buddhism, Vajrayana, Hinayana, etc. It is also found in the Tibetan Borno religion, which is very similar to our Dharmic religions. It is also found in Nepalese shamanism, etc. So the left-handed swastika, it is more of a heterodox kind of version, but it is also considered to be auspicious in various other contexts. Especially in Japan, if you look at the samurai, for example, they use both forms of the swastika. And in various other Buddhist countries, you will find the left-handed form of the swastika more prevalent. It is also one of the auspicious symbols associated with the Buddha. There are a list of 64, I believe, or I may be wrong, but there is a list of symbols associated with the Buddha, and the left-handed swastika is one of those. So it is still an auspicious symbol, but in India, I believe we tend to see it as a negative symbol because it is the mirror opposite of the mainstream swastika. But in other countries, in other offshoots of Indian culture, it is still a positive symbol. So that's about your question, how the different interpretations of the swastika are made.
And what about the other conceptions associated with this?
Could you please elaborate?
You have some slides to show on the other concepts associated with swastikas. So we could go through them.
Yeah, so if you could go to slide number 3, please. Right, so let's look at the meaning of the swastika. So the word swastik is a Sanskrit word, of course. It is a sandhi of two words, su and asti. Su, obviously, we know very well, like suagat, etc. Su means good, well, auspicious, etc. And asti means it is or there is. So su asti means there is auspiciousness, there is well-being, etc. So the word swastika essentially means that. It means everything positive. It means health, luck, good fortune, success, prosperity, positivity, auspiciousness, well-being. It essentially conveys this aura of positivity and auspiciousness. So that is what the swastika is. That is the Sanskrit word that is now commonly used throughout the world. But even in other languages, in other cultures, it has always had the same meaning. So that is the ancient meaning of the swastika and the connotation that it carries throughout the world in all cultures. Now, if you want to look at the origin of the swastika, which is a very interesting topic. So if you look at hard empirical evidence from the world of archaeology, then we find that the oldest example of the swastika in the archaeological record is about 10 to 15,000 years old. It is found in Ukraine. So it's a statue or a figurine of a bird that is carved from mammoth ivory. Mammoths were enormous woolly elephants that lived in the frozen cold regions of the world. So this swastika is about 10 to 15,000 years old. It is the oldest known example of the swastika. That doesn't mean that it's the oldest swastika in the world, because I believe that the swastika which is found in India could be even older, but unfortunately our historians and archaeologists have not done anything in the past 70 years. They have excavated nothing. So we don't know what lies below the surface of our country. For example, in the Saraswati civilization, there are more than 2,000 minimum sites, archaeological sites, that have never been excavated and explored. And this is just along one river, the Saraswati. There are thousands more. So our civilization could be well older than what we believe it is. And we may find very old in ancient examples of the swastika if we bother, if our archaeologists and historians would bother to do their work properly. Anyhow, let's go to the next slide, please. So now the question arises that how did this geometrical form, this geometrical figure, how did it come to become a symbol of positivity and auspiciousness throughout the world, in all these different disparate, disconnected cultures throughout the world? That is a very relevant question. And it looks like this symbol arose spontaneously and simultaneously in different parts of the world. And everywhere it is universally considered to be auspicious, especially in the ancient world. So how did this happen? So there are a couple of theories. One theory says that the swastika is a combination of four celestial constellations around the North Star. And this is what you see in the figure on the screen. Now, I am not a very big proponent of this theory because you would need to be astronomically very well literate to be able to make this sort of connection. There are many cultures that have not been known to be astronomically inclined, and they also see the swastika as a very positive and auspicious sign. So could you please go to the next slide? Right, so I believe that there is a different reason why the swastika arose as a symbol of positivity throughout the world. I believe it was a celestial symbol, but not the one shown in the previous figure. So let me make a small astronomical diversion. So we are aware of what the solar system is. We have the sun at the center, then we have the inner planets, Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars. Then we have the asteroid belt. Then we have the gas giants, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune. Then you have the minor planets in what is known as the Kuiper belt. That includes Pluto, Eris, Haumea, Makemake, Sedna, etc., a whole bunch of minor planets. And outside that, if you go further out, you have what's known as the Oort cloud, which is a vast collection of frozen bodies. So these frozen bodies are a mixture of water, ice, dust, rocks, and organic compounds. And these are what are known as the comets. You can think of them as giant, dirty ice balls, snowballs. So this Oort cloud is very stable. But every once in a while, what happens is that there is some kind of a gravitational disturbance which launches one of these bodies towards the inner solar system. And when that happens, this eventually becomes a comet. So as this frozen ball of ice comes towards the inner solar system, once it crosses the orbit of Jupiter, then it starts interacting with the solar wind, with solar radiation, and it heats up. So what happens is that the water ice starts evaporating, and the dust also starts evaporating with it. And because of the effect of the solar wind, all of this water, ice, and dust is pushed out in the direction opposite to the sun. And because of the solar wind, it starts glowing. And that's how a comet acquires a tail. So we see comets all the time. There is a comet in the sky right now, if the Indian monsoon will allow us to see it. And most comets have a single tail. So it's one ball with a long tail behind it. But every once in a while, in rare occasions, you will see a comet with two tails, and that happens once in a few decades. An even rarer occurrence is when a comet has three tails. That would happen once in a few centuries. And the rarest occurrence of all would be a comet with four tails, which I expect would happen once in a few thousand years. So could you put the next slide, please? So I believe what happened once upon a time, more than 10,000-15,000 years ago, was that there appeared in the sky a comet with four tails. And it was a very big comet, which was visible from everywhere on the surface of this planet. And so we had this comet with four tails in the shape of a cross. And because of the solar wind, the comet twisted. It rotated by 90 degrees. And those four tails became bent in the shape of a swastika. And what the entire world observed was this enormous glowing swastika in the sky. And it so happened that at the same time that this swastika appeared in the sky, it was a very good year, with very good weather, very good climate, no natural calamities, no disasters, no illnesses, no problems, good harvests, and a very good year all around. And therefore, this image of this celestial swastika got connected with prosperity and auspiciousness and good health and everything positive. And this is how I believe that in the ancient world, more than 15,000 years ago, this image of the swastika in the sky and its association with positivity and auspiciousness got imprinted in the collective cultural and racial memories of different people throughout the world. And it is well known that these racial memories and collective cultural memories persist for thousands of years. It's been demonstrated. And that's what happened. Yes, sir.
Well, that's a very interesting explanation. I think that's the theoretical physicist speaking. And honestly, even I have heard this explanation for the first time. So I'm sure that viewers would find it most interesting. Now, what is the swastik phobia which is got generated after the Nazi symbol got mistaken as the swastika? I think that is something that most of our viewers would be interested in finding out.
Right, so this all began with one Mr. Adolf Hitler. So Adolf Hitler was a supremacist. He was a nationalist, he was a supremacist, and he was a very racist person. He believed in the supremacy of the white race, of the Nordic race. He believed the German people were a part of this superior race, the Übermensch, which he called. And so he believed that this white Nordic race is the so-called Aryan race because of this Aryan invasion theory, which was propagated by people like Max Müller and all those people. So he believed that the Nordic German people were the original Aryan race, and therefore he was looking for a symbol to associate with this superior Aryan race. And he found the symbol in the swastika. But what he did was that he twisted the swastika. The symbol that you see on the screen, a black swastika with a red background, that is the symbol that he chose for his political party and for his country. And that is the symbol under which all the atrocities of the Third Reich were committed. So in Europe and in the Western world, this symbol became associated with the barbarity and the atrocities and the genocide that the Nazis perpetrated. Now, the thing is this, Hitler called this symbol the Hakenkreuz, the hooked cross. So in Nazi Germany, this symbol was known as the hooked cross, the Hakenkreuz. It was not called the swastika. After the Second World War was over, after the Nazis were defeated, the name swastika was attached to the symbol retrospectively. And that's how the word swastika, which had such a positive meaning for millennia, suddenly acquired this extremely negative connotation in the Western world. And just like the name Adolf went out of usage, the same way in the Western world, the swastika also went out of usage. And they actually did a witch hunt against the swastika. Wherever you have a swastika, anybody who uses the swastika is looked upon as somebody who is either a terrorist or a racist or a white supremacist and all that. So it has a very negative connotation today. And the way of the Western world is that they impose their worldview upon everybody else. So today, if I were to go to the West, I cannot wear a necklace with a swastika on it. I cannot wear a bracelet with swastikas on it. I cannot even carry that in the luggage. Because if it turns up in the X-rays, they will look upon me as a terrorist, and I may get the privilege of being treated like a Pakistani, you know, a strip search and a cavity search and all that. So we simply cannot use the swastika the way we use it in India or in Asia. We cannot do that in the West. So it's been completely tabooed. It's been essentially banned. It's been canceled, cancel culture. So that's what's happening.
The Hakenkreuz is actually a Christian symbol.
It is, yes. It is not the Indo-European symbol. It is not the Hindu symbol. It is not the auspicious symbol. It is a twisted swastika. It is a certain instance of the swastika. It's a Christian symbol, like you said. And that's been, unfortunately, and maliciously associated with the Hindu swastika and the benevolent swastika. And I see this as an example of maliciousness and of Hindu phobia. Because today, the swastika is primarily associated with dharmic culture. It's been removed from everywhere else in the world. So this is an example of Hindu phobia, and it's prevalent today, and it's actually increasing in intensity, even in India today.
Okay, that's not very that's not only interesting, but we also find that some Marxists and some other kind of what is called the neo-socialist types in India are also using that as a negative symbol. I think you have one of those instances in your slide.
Yes, the last slide, I believe, last one. Yeah, the last slide. So the thing is this, I have always said that India is the world's most Hindu-phobic country. Unfortunately, that is the truth. Hindu-phobia is enshrined in our constitution, in our laws, in our public policies, etc. It is enshrined in the media. The cabal that runs the, that essentially determines public opinion in India is what I call the M4 complex, Mullah Marxist Missionary Media. They are the ones who control the narrative, the public narrative, and you find this even among mainstream politicians. So they are extremely rabidly Hindu-phobic. They have an agenda to remove Hinduism from the country and replace it with something else. So this is a very good opportunity for them because the whole world sees the swastika, especially the Western world, sees the swastika as a symbol of negativity. So they are trying to infuse that into India now. And that's what's happening, especially in the colleges, in the universities, in higher academia, and now in the media, in public discourse, via memes of various kinds, and even politicians are doing that. So this is a trend that I see increasing in prevalence in the past few years, especially in the past 5-6 years. And the way to combat this is by educating people about our own culture, which we don't do. Our history textbooks do not. Cautiously hopeful.
I think this video would go a long way towards educating people. And I think that was the reason that why I chose this particular topic. I'm sure anybody who goes through this particular talk of Avijit Chawla would be able to understand what really swastika is and what its origins are and why it's always been a symbol of auspiciousness. Whether it is the right-handed type or the left-handed type, both types have always been symbols of auspiciousness in the dharmic philosophy, in the tantric philosophy, and not just in India, but all over the world. And therefore, any phobia associated with this auspicious symbol is not just totally misplaced, but also completely misconceived. I'm sure that this particular talk will help educate people and help them conquer whatever little vestiges of phobia they might have had or that might have been imposed on them by this Mullah missionary Marxist Hindu-phobic leadership of our media people and our Lutyens elites and the kind. Thank you very much, Avijit. This has been a most enlightening talk, and I'm sure that you've been exploring a lot of these topics, and some of these we'll be able to present to our people in future as well. Thank you and Namaskar.
Thank you. Namaskar.